This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. President of the United States First Term Campaign for the Presidency 1932 First Inauguration Presidency New Deal First 100 Days Glass-Steagall Act WPA Social Security SEC Fireside Chats Second Term Landslide Re-Election 1936 Second Inauguration Supreme Court Packing National Recovery Act 1937 Recession March of Dimes Pre-War Foreign Policy Third Term Re-Election 1943 Inauguration Attack on Pearl Harbor World War II Infamy Speech Japanese Internment Tehran Conference United Nations D-Day Second Bill of Rights GI Bill Fourth Term Re-Election 1944 Fourth Inauguration Yalta Conference Declining Health Death and State Funeral Legacy Presidential Library Criticism Critics of the New Deal 22 Amendment Civil Rights Memorial V. E. Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Roosevelt, his own pronunciation, or, Roosevelt, January 30, 1882 to April 12, 1945, commonly known as FDR, was an American statesman and political leader who served as the 32nd President of the United States from 1933 until his death in 1945. A Democrat, he won a record 4 presidential elections and dominated his party after 1932 as a central figure in world events during the mid-20th century, leading the United States during a time of worldwide economic depression and a total war. His program for relief, recovery, and reform, known as the New Deal, involved a great expansion of the federal government's role in the economy as a dominant leader of the Democratic Party. He built the New Deal coalition that brought together and united labor unions, big city machines, white ethnics, African Americans, and rural white Southerners in support of the party. The coalition significantly realigned American politics after 1932, creating the fifth party system and defining American liberalism throughout the middle third of the 20th century. Roosevelt was born in 1882, to an old, prominent Dutch family from Dutchess County, New York. He attended the elite educational institutions of Groton School and Harvard College in Massachusetts at age 23 in 1905. He married Eleanor Roosevelt, with whom he had 6 children. He entered politics in 1910, serving in the New York State Senate, and then as Assistant Secretary of the Navy under President Woodrow Wilson in 1920. Roosevelt ran for vice president with presidential candidate James M. Cox, but the Cox-Roosevelt ticket lost to the Republican ticket of Warren Harding and Calvin Coolidge. Roosevelt was stricken with debilitating polio in 1921, which cost him the use of his legs and put his future political career in jeopardy, but he attempted to recover from the illness, and founded the Treatment Center for People with Polio in Warm Springs, Georgia after returning to political life by placing Alfred E. Smith's name into nomination at the 1924 Democratic National Convention. Roosevelt, at Smith's behest, successfully ran for governor of New York in 1928 in office from 1929 to 1930. He served as a reform governor promoting the enactment of programs to combat the Great Depression besetting the United States at the time in 1932, in the depths of the Great Depression, Roosevelt successfully defeated incumbent Republican President Herbert Hoover to win the presidency of the United States. Having been energized by his personal victory over his polio, FDR relied on his persistent optimism and activism to renew the national spirit in his first 100 days in office, which began March. Act, the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation and Social Security as World War II loomed after 1938, with the Japanese invasion of China and the aggression of Nazi Germany. Roosevelt gave strong diplomatic and financial support to China and the United Kingdom, while remaining officially neutral. His goal was to make America the arsenal of democracy, which would supply munitions to the Allies in March. The industrial economy grew rapidly to new heights as millions of people moved to wartime factory jobs or entered military service. Roosevelt's health seriously declined during the war years, and he died 3 months into his fourth term. He is often rated by scholars as one of the top 3 U.S. presidents, along with Abraham Lincoln and George Washington. Contents 1. Personal life 11. Early life and education 12. Marriage and affairs 2. Early political career 21. State senator and Tammany antagonist 22. Assistant secretary of the Navy 23. Campaign for Vice President 3. Polio 4. Governor of New York 1929-32-5-1932. Presidential Election 6. Presidency 1933-45-61. First Term 1933-37611. First New Deal 1933-34. 612 Second New Deal 1935–36613 Economic Policies 614 Conservation and the Environment 615 Foreign Policy 1933-37-62 Landslide re-election, 1936–63 Second Term 1937–41631 Foreign Policy 1937-41-64 Election of 1940–65 Third Term 1941–45651 Policies 652 Pearl Harbor and Declarations of War 66 War Plans 661 Internment of Germans, Italians and Japanese 662 War Strategy 663 Post-War Planning 67 Declining Health 68 Election of 1944–69 Fourth Term and Death 1945 691 Last Days, Death and Memorial 610 Supreme Court Appointments 1933-45-7 Civil Rights 8 Criticism 9 Legacy 10 Appendix 101 Cabinet 102 Media 11 See also 12 EndMatter 121 Notes 122 References 123 Bibliography 1231 Biographical 1232 Scholarly Topical Studies 1233 Foreign Policy and World War II 1234 Criticism 1235 FDR's rhetoric. 124 Historiography 1241 Primary sources 13 External links Personal life See also, Roosevelt family and Delano family Early life and education One of the oldest Dutch families in New York State, the Roosevelts distinguished themselves in areas other than politics One ancestor, Isaac Roosevelt, had served with the New York militia during the American Revolution Roosevelt attended events of the New York Society Sons of the American Revolution, and joined the organization while he was president His paternal family had become prosperous early on in New York real estate and trade, and much of his immediate family's wealth had been built by FDR's maternal grandfather, Warren Delano Jr., in the China trade, including opium and tea A young, unbreached Roosevelt in 1884, 2 years old Roosevelt was born on January. Ancestry, and his mother's maiden name, Delano, could be traced to a French Huguenot immigrant ancestor of the 17th century Their only child was to have been named Warren, but Sarah's infant nephew of that name had recently died Their son was named for Sarah's uncle Franklin Hughes Delano Roosevelt grew up in an atmosphere of privilege Reportedly, when James Roosevelt took his 5-year-old son to visit President Grover Cleveland in the White House, the busy president told Franklin, "I have one wish for you, little man, that you will never be president of the United States." Sarah was a possessive mother. James, 54 when Franklin was born, was considered by some as a remote father, though biographer James McGregor Burns indicates James interacted with his son more than was typical at the time Sarah was the dominant influence in Franklin's early years. She once declared, "My son Franklin is a Delano, not a Roosevelt at all." During his childhood, Roosevelt and his mother Sarah spent every summer and major holidays together at the Delano Homestead in Fairhaven, Massachusetts. Franklin would use the Delano Homestead as his home on weekends when he eventually enrolled into the prestigious institutions of Groton and Harvard, also located in the state. Frequent trips to Europe, he made his first at the age of 2, and went with his parents every year from the ages of 7 to 15, helped Roosevelt become conversant in German and French, being arrested with his tutor by police 4 times in one day in the Black Forest for minor offenses may have affected the future president's view of German character He learned to ride, shoot, row, and play polo and lawn tennis Roosevelt also took up golf in his teen years, becoming a skilled long hitter He learned to sail, and his father gave him a sailboat at the age of 16 which he named New Moon Roosevelt attended Groton School, an Episcopal boarding school in Groton, Massachusetts, 90% of the students were from families on the social register He was strongly influenced by its headmaster, Endicott Peabody, who preached the duty of Christians to help the less fortunate and urged his students to enter public service 40 years later Roosevelt said of Peabody, "It was a blessing in my life to have the privilege of guiding hand," and the headmaster remained a strong influence throughout his life, officiating at his wedding and visiting Roosevelt as President Peabody recalled Roosevelt as a quiet, satisfactory boy of more than ordinary intelligence, taking a good position in his form but not brilliant, while a classmate described Roosevelt as nice, but completely colorless, an average student, he only stood out in being the only Democratic student, continuing the political tradition of his side of the Roosevelt family Roosevelt remained consistent in his politics. Immediately after his 4th election to the presidency, he defined his domestic policy as a little left of center like all but 2 of his 21 Groton classmates. Roosevelt went to Harvard College in nearby Cambridge, Massachusetts, where he lived in a suite which is now part of Adams House, in the Gold Coast area populated by wealthy students. His mother Sarah moved to Boston in 1900 to be closer to her son, again an average student academically. Roosevelt later declared, "I took economics courses in college for 4 years, and everything I was taught was wrong." He was a member of the Alpha Delta Phi fraternity and the Fly Club. While undistinguished as a student or athlete, he became editor-in-chief of the Harvard Crimson Daily newspaper, a position which required great ambition, energy, and ability to manage others while he was at Harvard. His fifth cousin Theodore T. York State Bar Exam. He later received a posthumous J.D. from Columbia Law School in 1908. He took a job with the prestigious Wall Street firm of Carter Ledyard. Biographer James McGregor Burns says young Roosevelt was self-assured and at ease in the upper class. In contrast, Eleanor at the time was shy and disliked social life, and at first stayed at home to raise their several children. Although Eleanor had an aversion to sexual intercourse, and considered it an ordeal to be endured, they had six children, the first four in rapid succession: Anna, Eleanor, Roosevelt, May. Franklin had contemplated divorcing Eleanor, but Lucy would not agree to marry a divorced man with five children. Franklin and Eleanor remained married, and FDR promised never to see Lucy again. Eleanor never truly forgave him, and their marriage from that point on was more of a political partnership. His mother Sarah told Franklin that if he divorced his wife, it would bring scandal upon the family, and she would not give him another dollar. Franklin broke his promise to Eleanor. He and Lucy maintained a formal correspondence, and began seeing each other again in 1941. Perhaps earlier, the Secret Service gave Lucy the code name Mrs. Johnson. Lucy was with FDR on the day he died in 1945. Despite this, FDR's affair was not widely known until the 1960s. Roosevelt's son Elliot said that Franklin also had a 20-year affair with his private secretary Marguerite Missy LeHand. Another son, James, stated that there is a real possibility that a romantic relationship existed between his father and Princess Martha of Sweden, who resided in the White House during part of World War II. Aides began to refer to her at the time as the president's girlfriend, and gossip linking the two romantically appeared in the newspapers. The effect of these flirtations or affairs upon Eleanor Roosevelt is difficult to estimate. "I have the memory of an elephant. I can forgive, but I cannot forget," she wrote to a close friend after the Lucy Mercer affair. Any remaining intimacy left their relationship. Eleanor soon thereafter established a separate house in Hyde Park at Val Kill, and increasingly devoted herself to various social and political causes independently of her husband. The emotional break in their marriage was so severe that when Roosevelt asked Eleanor in 1942, in light of his failing health, to come back home and live with him again, she refused. He was not always aware of when she visited the White House, and for some time she could not easily reach him on the telephone without his secretary's help. He, in turn, did not visit her New York City apartment until late 1944, when Roosevelt was president. His dog, Fala, also became well known as his companion during his time in the White House. Fala was called the most photographed dog in the world. The birthplace of FDR at Springwood. Roosevelt sailing with half-niece Helen and father James, 1899. Franklin and Eleanor at Campobello Island, Canada, in 1904. Franklin and Eleanor statues at FDR National Historic Site in Hyde Park, New York. Franklin left with nephew Tad Middle and niece Helen Wright in January. Since 1856, the local party chose him as a paper candidate because his Republican cousin Theodore was still one of the country's most prominent politicians, and a Democratic Roosevelt was good publicity. The candidate could also pay for his own campaign, surprising almost everyone. Due to his aggressive and effective campaign, the Roosevelt name's influence in the Hudson Valley, and the Democratic landslide that year, Roosevelt won the election, taking his seat on January. Despite a bout of typhoid fever, and thanks to the help of Lewis McHenry Howe, who ran his campaign, Roosevelt was re-elected for a second term in the state election of 1912, and served as chairman of the Agriculture Committee. His success with farm and labor bills was a precursor to his New Deal policies 20 years later. By this time he had become more consistently progressive, in support of labor and social welfare programs for women and children. Cousin Theodore was of some influence on these issues. Roosevelt, again in opposition to Tammany Hall, supported Southerner Woodrow Wilson's successful bid in the 1912 presidential election, and thereby earned an informal designation as an original Wilson man. Assistant Secretary of the Navy Roosevelt as Assistant Secretary of the Navy, 1913. Roosevelt's support of Wilson led to his appointment in 1913 as Assistant Secretary of the Navy under Secretary of the Navy Josephus Daniels. Roosevelt had a lifelong affection for the Navy. He had already collected almost 10,000 naval books and claimed to have read all but one, and was more ardent than his boss Daniels in supporting a large and efficient naval force as Assistant Secretary. Roosevelt worked to expand the Navy and founded the United States Navy Reserve against reactionary older officers such as Admiral William Benson, who claimed he could not conceive of any use the fleet will ever have for aviation. Roosevelt personally ordered the preservation of the Navy's aviation division after the war, despite publicly opining that Billy Mitchell's warnings of bombs capable of sinking battleships were pernicious. Roosevelt negotiated with congressional leaders and other government departments to get budgets approved. He opposed the Taylor stopwatch system, which was hailed by shipbuilding managers but opposed by the unions. Not a single union strike occurred during his 7+ years in the office, during which Roosevelt gained experience in labor issues, government management during wartime, naval issues, and logistics, all valuable areas for future office. Roosevelt was still relatively obscure, but his friends were already speaking of him as a future president. He reportedly began talking about being elected to the presidency as early as 1907. In 1914, Roosevelt made an ill-conceived decision to run for the U.S. Senate seat for New York. The decision was doomed for lack of Wilson administration backing. He was determined to take on Tammany again at a time when Wilson needed them to help marshal his legislation and secure his future re-election. He was soundly defeated in the Democratic primary election for the United States Senate by Tammany Hall-backed James W. Girard. By a margin of 3-1, Roosevelt learned a valuable lesson, that federal patronage alone, without White House support, could not defeat a strong local organization in March. Enthusiastic advocate of the submarine and of means to combat the German submarine menace to Allied shipping, he proposed building a mine barrier across the North Sea from Norway to Scotland in 1918. He visited Scotland, England, Wales, and France to inspect American naval facilities. Roosevelt wanted to provide arms to the merchant marine. Knowing that a sale of arms was prohibited, he asked Wilson for approval to lease the arms to the mariners. Wilson ultimately approved this by executive order, and a precedent was set for Roosevelt to take similar action in 1940. During these war years, Roosevelt worked to make peace with the Tammany Hall forces, and in 1918 the group supported others in an unsuccessful attempt to persuade him to run for governor of New York. He very much wanted to get into a military uniform, but the armistice took shape before this could materialize. Wilson reportedly ordered Roosevelt to not resign with the end of World War I in November. House, which they had walked past just minutes before their own residence, was close enough that one of the bomber's body parts landed on their doorstep. Campaign for Vice President Cox and Roosevelt in Ohio, 1920. The 1920 Democratic National Convention chose Roosevelt by acclamation as the vice presidential candidate, with its presidential candidate, Governor James M. Cox of Ohio. Although his nomination surprised most people, Roosevelt was considered as bringing balance to the ticket as a moderate, a Wilsonian, and a prohibitionist. With a famous name, Roosevelt had just turned 38, 4 years younger than Theodore had been when he received the same nomination from his party. The Cox-Roosevelt ticket was defeated by Republicans Warren G. Harding and Calvin Coolidge in the presidential election by a wide margin. Roosevelt returned to New York to practice law and joined the newly organized New York Civitan Club. Polio. Main article, Franklin D. Roosevelt's paralytic illness. Rare photograph of FDR in a wheelchair, with Falla and Ruthie Bie, the daughter of caretakers at his Hyde Park estate. Photo taken by his cousin Margaret Suckley. February 1941. In August, Brunswick, Canada, Roosevelt fell ill and was diagnosed with polio 236. It left him with permanent paralysis from the waist down. Following the illness, Roosevelt remained out of the public eye for several years, turning his attention away from politics and toward his legal practice and his various indoor hobbies such as reading and stamp collecting for the rest of his life. Roosevelt refused to accept that he was permanently paralyzed. He tried a wide range of therapies, including hydrotherapy. In 1926, he purchased a resort at Warm Springs, Georgia, where he founded a hydrotherapy center for the treatment of polio patients. It still operates as the Roosevelt Warm Springs Institute for Rehabilitation. In 1938, FDR founded the National Foundation for Infantile Paralysis, now known as the March of Dimes at the time. Roosevelt convinced many people that he was improving, which he believed to be essential prior to running for public office again. He laboriously taught himself to walk short distances while wearing iron braces on his hips and legs by swiveling his torso, supporting himself with a cane. He was careful never to be seen using his wheelchair in public, and great care was taken to prevent any portrayal in the press that would highlight his disability. 332 few photographs of FDR in his wheelchair are known. They include two taken by his cousin and confidant Margaret Suckley, another taken by a sailor aboard the USS Indianapolis in 1933, and another published in a 1937 issue of Life magazine. 332-333 film clips of the walk he achieved after his illness are equally rare. He usually appeared in public standing upright, supported on one side by an aide or one of his sons. FDR used a car with specially designed hand controls, providing him further mobility. A 2003 retrospective diagnosis of Roosevelt's paralytic illness favored Guillain-Barré syndrome rather than polio, a conclusion criticized by other researchers. Governor of New York 1929-32 main article, Governorship of Franklin D. Roosevelt. Then Gov. Roosevelt with his predecessor Al Smith. In 1930, Roosevelt maintained contacts and mended fences with the Democratic Party during the 1920s, especially in New York. Although he initially had made his name as an opponent of New York City's Tammany Hall machine, Roosevelt moderated his stance against that group as well. He helped Alfred E. Smith win the election for governor of New York in 1922, and in 1924 was a strong supporter of Smith against his cousin, Republican Theodore Roosevelt Jr. Roosevelt gave nominating speeches for Smith at the 1924 and 1928 Democratic conventions. The speech at the 1924 election marked a return to public life following his illness and convalescence as the Democratic Party presidential nominee in the 1928 election. Smith in turn asked Roosevelt to run for governor in the state election. Roosevelt was nominated by the Democrats by acclamation, while Smith lost the presidency in a landslide and was defeated in his home state. Roosevelt was narrowly elected governor, by a 1% margin as a reform governor. He established a number of new social programs, and was advised by Francis Perkins and Harry Hopkins in April. 1932 presidential election main article, United States presidential election, 1932 electoral vote results. Roosevelt's strong base in the most populous state made him an obvious candidate for the Democratic nomination, which was hotly contested in light of incumbent Herbert Hoover's vulnerability. Al Smith was supported by some city bosses, but had lost control of the New York Democratic Party to Roosevelt. Roosevelt built his own national coalition with personal allies such as newspaper magnate William Randolph Hearst, Irish leader Joseph P. Kennedy Sr., and California leader William Gibbs McAdoo. When Texas leader John Nance Garner announced his support of FDR, he was given the vice presidential nomination, breaking with tradition of the time. Roosevelt traveled to Chicago to accept the nomination in person. In his acceptance speech, Roosevelt declared, I pledge myself to a new deal for the American people. This is more than a political campaign, it is a call to arms. The election campaign was conducted under the shadow of the Great Depression in the United States, and the new alliances which it created. Roosevelt and the Democratic Party mobilized the expanded ranks of the poor as well as organized labor, ethnic minorities, urbanites, and Southern whites, crafting the New Deal coalition. At that time, African Americans in the South were still disfranchised, as they had been since the turn of the century. Southern states had passed a variety of requirements making voter registration more difficult, which served to exclude most blacks and many poor whites from the political system. Economist Mariner Eccles observed that, given later developments, the campaign speeches often read like a giant misprint, in which Roosevelt and Hoover speak each other's lines. Roosevelt denounced Hoover's failures to restore prosperity or halt the downward slide, and he ridiculed Hoover's huge deficits. Roosevelt campaigned on the Democratic platform advocating immediate and drastic reduction of all public expenditures, abolishing useless commissions and offices, consolidating departments and bureaus, and eliminating extravagances, and for a sound currency to be maintained at all hazards. On September started what is called the New Deal Party System, or by political scientists the Fifth Party System. After the election, Roosevelt refused Hoover's requests for a meeting to develop a joint program to stop the downward spiral and calm investors, claiming publicly it would tie his hands, and that Hoover had all the power to act if necessary, and officially, he told reporters that "it is not my baby." The economy spiraled downward until the banking system began a complete nationwide shutdown as Hoover's term ended in February. Roosevelt appointed powerful men to top positions but made certain he made all the major decisions, regardless of delays, inefficiency or resentment. Analyzing the president's administrative style, historian James McGregor Burns concludes, "The president stayed in charge of his administration by drawing fully on his formal and informal powers as chief executive, by raising goals, creating momentum, inspiring a personal loyalty, getting the best out of people by deliberately fostering among his aides a sense of competition and a clash of wills that led to disarray, heartbreak, and anger, but also set off pulses of executive energy and sparks of creativity by handing out one job to several men and several jobs to one man, thus strengthening his own position as a court of appeals, as a depository of information, and as a tool of coordination, by ignoring or bypassing collective decision-making agencies, such as the cabinet, and always by persuading, flattering, juggling, improvising, reshuffling, harmonizing, conciliating, manipulating." First term 1933-37. See also, New Deal. Outgoing President Herbert Hoover and Roosevelt on Inauguration Day, 1933, when Roosevelt was inaugurated. March. Million people were homeless by the evening of March. Urgently needed by tens of millions of unemployed, recovery meant boosting the economy back to normal. Reform meant long-term fixes of what was wrong, especially with the financial and banking systems. Through Roosevelt's series of radio talks, known as fireside chats, he presented his proposals directly to the American public in 1934. FDR paid a visit to retired Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, who mused about the president, a second-class intellect but a first-class temperament. First New Deal 1933-34. Roosevelt's first 100 days concentrated on the first part of his strategy, immediate relief from March. Glass-Steagall Act that created the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, FDIC, to underwrite savings deposits. Nothing to fear. Sample of the inaugural speech from FDR. Problems playing this file. See media help. Relief measures included the continuation of Hoover's major relief program for the unemployed under its new name, Federal Emergency Relief Administration, the most popular of all New Deal agencies. The rules of operation for all firms within specific industries, such as minimum prices, agreements not to compete, and production restrictions. Industry leaders negotiated the codes which were approved by NERA officials. Industry needed to raise wages as a condition for approval. Provisions encouraged unions and suspended antitrust laws. The NERA was found to be unconstitutional by unanimous decision of the U.S. Supreme Court on May. History. January. While the first New Deal of 1933 had broad support from most sectors, the second New Deal challenged the business community. Conservative Democrats, led by Al Smith, fought back with the American Liberty League, savagely attacking Roosevelt and equating him with Karl Marx and Vladimir Lenin. But Smith overplayed his hand, and his boisterous rhetoric let Roosevelt isolate his opponents and identify them with the wealthy vested interests that opposed the New Deal, strengthening Roosevelt for the 1936 landslide. By contrast, the labor union, energized by the Wagner Act, signed up millions of new members and became a major backer of Roosevelt's re-elections in 1936, 1940, and 1944. Larry Schweikert and Michael Allen disagree with the prevailing belief that there were two New Deals in the Roosevelt administration. They argue that there is no evidence of any such blueprint for Roosevelt's programs, and that abundant evidence shows FDR's policies were formulated and executed haphazardly, fluctuating in the hands of a revolving cast of presidential advisors. Biographer James M. Burns suggests that Roosevelt's policy decisions were guided more by pragmatism than ideology, and that he was like the general of a guerrilla army whose columns, fighting blindly in the mountains through dense ravines and thickets, suddenly converge, half by plan and half by coincidence, and debouch into the plain below. Roosevelt argued that such apparently haphazard methodology was necessary. The country needs an, unless I mistake its temper, the country demands bold, persistent experimentation, he wrote. It is common sense to take a method and try it. If it fails, admit it frankly and try another, but above all, try something. Economic policies. See also, Great Depression in the United States, section. jobs, with an average annual increase in jobs during his administration of 53%. Roosevelt considered his New Deal policies as central to his legacy, and in his 1944 State of the Union address, he advocated that Americans should think of basic economic rights as a second Bill of Rights play. Media. Franklin Delano Roosevelt announced the plan for a Bill of Social and Economic Rights in the State of the Union address broadcast on January. Taxes, but also introduced withholding taxes in 1943. Conservation and the environment. Roosevelt had a lifelong interest in the environment and conservation, starting with his youthful interest in forestry on his family estate as governor and president. He launched numerous projects for conservation, in the name of protecting the environment, and providing beauty and jobs for the people. He was strengthened in his resolve by the model of his cousin Theodore Roosevelt. Although FDR was never an outdoorsman or sportsman on TR scale, his growth of the national systems were comparable. FDR created 140 national wildlife refuges especially for birds and established 29 national forests and 29 national parks and monuments. He thereby achieved the vision he had set out in 1931. Heretofore, our conservation policy has been merely to preserve as much as possible of the existing forests. Our new policy goes a step further. It will not only preserve the existing forests, but create new ones. As president, he was active in expanding, funding, and promoting the national park and national forest systems. He used relief agencies to upgrade the facilities. Their popularity soared, from 3 million visitors a year at the start of the decade, to 155 million in 1939. His favorite agency was the Civilian Conservation Corps CCC, which expended most of its effort on environmental projects. The CCC in a dozen years enrolled 34 million young men.